Hey everyone, welcome to Magic TV. I'm Tristan Shaun Gregson here with Luis Scott-Vargas. We're doing top eight of the week this week. Again, this one comes in from Twitter. I don't remember who suggested it to you.
Hold on. Inkwell Looter. Bam.
All right, there we go. Yeah. The internet's famous Inkwell Looter. We're talking about top eight kind of offbeat draft strategies.
Yeah, well, just top eight awesome decks to draft.
Which usually means offbeat, which usually means...
Yeah, well, basically, the main criteria was... In this deck, would you take a borderline playable slash unplayable uncommon over like a dragon? Because all these decks share that characteristic where you want... It basically, when synergy starts trumping power, it's perfect. That's exactly what I'm looking for. Because 90% of draft decks, you know, when you open a dragon or a fireball or whatever, you'll take it over whatever other cards are in the pack. This deck isn't interested in the most powerful card or the best card. It's interested in the one that fits the deck the best.
I would imagine most of the archetypes on this list involve taking out your opponent's library.
Some of them. And some of them, a fairly key thing that shows up a lot here is also your win condition is not just playing creatures and attacking with them. Your win condition is something sweet. Let's just get into it. Let's start with number eight. This is the one that's probably the sketchiest on the list, because almost all the other ones are actually really, really good. This one's actually not good.
Oh, okay. Well, that's a good place to start.
But it bears mentioning only because it also wrecked Paulo's Pro Tour Philadelphia.
And this is why this is not an honorable mention. This is number eight because it beat Paulo. We're talking M12.
The mill deck.
And the mill deck.
The sweetest version was the Turbo Fog one, where you had Mind Unbound, preferably two if you could, Elixir of Immortality, a bunch of Fogs, Brindle Boars, Jace's Erasures, just ways to stall the game, maybe Merfolk Mesmerist, and Mind Unbound was really the key here. You start drawing a ton of cards, you're recycling your Fogs and stuff with Elixir, and then Jace's Erasures just milling them right out. And the reason this deck wasn't good is because without Mind Unbound, the deck just didn't work. Like, it really just didn't work. I drafted a lot of different Jace's Erasure or Merfolk Mesmerist decks, and they were not good. So,
relying on a 6-mana rare enchantment that, when you cast it, doesn't do anything.
Right.
Seems and pretty loose.
Yeah, Rites of Flourishing was perfect in the deck, too. But, again, this was not a deck you could really count on drafting or want to draft. But when it worked, it was actually really very good.
So, for the kids at home, when you M12 draft now, and you... open the Mind Unbound.
I mean, I would just slam Mind Unbound and start going into Turbo Fog. But
again, more bacon, more fog, yeah, more elixir. These are the things you're looking for.
That's Brindle Boar, by the way. But yeah. So anyway, let's move on to number seven.
This one I can get behind. This one I've drafted a lot.
This was actually the best deck in the format for a while. This is in Triple Shadowmoor when drafting Mono Red. And the reason this deck was so sick is that it used a bunch of underplayed commons that no one else wanted, and your deck was just so good. I guess the centerpiece of this deck was Intimidator Initiate. 1-mana 1/1 that whenever you play a red spell, you can pay one and make them unable to block. The reason he was so sick was, first of all, he was a 1-drop. So when you played your Mudbrawler cohort, the 1/1 haste that was a 2/2 if you had a red card in play.
Mm-hmm.
Both these cards always wheeled at the beginning. When people caught on, they stopped. But initially, you would take your good card over these cards.
Javelin or Puncture Bolt or...
Yeah, well, Puncture Bolt's a different set. Sorry, you're talking the 2-mana one, yeah. I was thinking Puncture Blast. But yeah, you take your good card over these, and then these wheel, because no one else wanted them. And you'd end up with a super aggressive, really, really good mono red deck, and like use all these sorts of haste guys, and then they could never block, and you would always outrace them. Like, this deck was sick. It was really very good. So
Your opponent often started at 14 or 12, and then you got to start using the Initiate's ability to make your opponent's guys not block,
exactly.
And the game ended real fast.
Turn 1 Initiate, turn 2 Mudbrawler cohort was actually just game. Like, they could never win. So, and this deck was sweet because, yeah, you would take, you know, you wanted Intimidator Initiate in your deck more than you wanted some crappy, like, 7-mana guy or 6-mana guy, even if he was, like, a bomb. So it was awesome. Moving on to number 6 is kind of the opposite. This was a Mystical Teachings-based decks during Time Spiral. And they actually even got better as the full block went on, I think.
But more cards with flash or more quality instants, probably.
Yeah, there's, like, I mean, you just ended up with a lot of, like, Mystical Teachings for Sproutstorm was a nice win condition. Yeah. Even from Triple Time Spiral, these decks ended up with like 3 to 4 creatures in them and then just all spells and like 2 teachings. And it was just so sweet. And sometimes you'd kill them with Empty the Warrens too. You'd like suspend a Mind Stab and a Rift Bolt, you know. Suspend Mind Stab, then suspend Rift Bolt, turn 4 is going to come out. And then play another spell, then play a Warrens for 8. And, you know, this deck was awesome. It was it was a blast to play and a blast to draft. Like
the card is so open-ended, you had a lot more tools at your disposal. You didn't have to get specific.
Yeah, this wasn't as all-in. This was actually one of the draft strategies that has the least amount of synergy on this list. So in this strategy, yeah, you would still always take the dragon over the synergy card because this deck was just a power deck. But Mystical Teaching still tied it all together and made it possible that you could play these like very, very, very creature-like decks.
It still very much changed your pick order and how you evaluated cards because, again, you could end up with many decks that were three or four threats at the end of the day.
You're not looking for any random creature. You're looking for a card advantage at almost any cost. So I still like that my last recorded Times Pro draft
happened to be a Mystical Teachings
deck. Was a four-color slivers Mystical Teachings.
But let's see the follow-up to that one. How are you going
to The follow-up to that one is a deck where on turn 14... they were still at 20, but had no lands in play. This is the...
For a second, I was still thinking Time Spiral, but no.
The Martyr of Ashes Icefall Grim Discovery deck. Okay, look, Triple Cold Snap is a much maligned draft format, but this deck was so fun. Your idea was you used Martyr of Ashes and other red removal spells to kill other creatures. You used Martyr of Ashes to also bring back, to use Recover on Icefall. So a typical game would be like, land go. Turn 3, maybe Martyr their board if they had something. Turn 4, Icefall them. Turn 5, Icefall them. Turn 6, Martyr, sack it, kill whatever guys they have, return both Icefalls to your hand. Icefall them. Grim Discovery back on Martyr. Like, you just chained all these cards. Between basically, the synergy of Red Martyr, Recover, and Icefall meant that you could kill all their creatures and blow up all their lands. Of course, you could never beat the Krovic and Mist deck that had a 7 Krovic and Mist, which had flying, but the deck was still awesome. It was very good against the
Cold Snap Limited. Yeah.
It was very good against the Surging Sentinel deck that had 10 Surging Sentinels because you just bam, Martyr of Ashes.
Yeah, the creatures for the most part in that format are pretty subpar. Again, anything that had flying, which was pretty much just the Mist deck. You've covered it. There's only like 8 creatures in that whole draft format anyway, and so you kill 7 of them.
Next up, we have another pretty recent deck, which is In Rise of the Eldrazi. This is the Shared Discovery Tokens deck. It didn't always have Shared Discovery.
Is it always 5 colors?
It's not always 5 colors. It usually was actually something like 3 to 4 colors.
Okay.
But basically, the idea was it used the token-making cards. So Emrakul's Hatcher was one of the best, Kozilek's Predator, but even like Essence Feed, that drain them for 3, put 3 tokens into play, Nest Invader. So, and then one of the key cards, so it used all those to make tokens, was Brood Birthing, which no one else wanted also. Again, a common theme is you're using cards no one wants.
Yeah, that's really the key to this particular deck and to remember overall is stuff that's, you remember seeing 12th, 13th pick,
anyone can win with the deck, to use right now, like a bunch of Diregraph Ghouls, Vampire Interlopers, like Victim of Knights and Deadweights, But these are cards that you're not going to consistently wheel or get late. But these, this tokens deck used all garbage. Like, you would use your early picks on Kozilek's Predator or like Emrakul's Hatcher or Staggershot because you still wanted actual spells, and all your late picks on these crappy token making cards, and then cards like Shared Discovery, which was really key because that's how you pulled ahead. You started Ancestraling in the mid game and you had 2 or 3 Ancestrals in your deck. It was awesome.
Yeah. Shared Discovery also went pretty late.
Yeah, so you had all these, and then you had various ways to utilize the tokens to kill them. And Shared Discovery is one of the sweeter ways, but there are plenty.
Raid Bombardment is not a must. But
no, it was actually kind of Raid Bombardment's on the weak side, but every now and then you have it. Brad played 2 in his top 8 deck with 5 creatures, but that was that was just because he had a bad deck.
That's a different story, I think.
The deck was a lot of fun. Rise of General was an awesome format, but this was one of the Josh Utterladen, who actually top 8 that Pro Tour, also was almost stone forcing this deck by the end of the format. It's the only deck he ever drafted. And he had Hellion Eruption, turn all your guys into 4/4, right, and all this stuff like that.
That's a bomb for that deck.
Yeah, it is. And it's not even a great card for other decks. It's okay, but not great. Whereas this deck, it's just,
I feel another top 8 coming on somewhere in the future. I think it's probably going to be top 8 Rise of the Eldrazi draft archetypes.
There are, I don't know, so if there many. Are that.
There are that many.
Okay, yeah, there are. Anyway,
remember that time we drafted 3 Lust for Wars?
Yeah, Lust for Wars was the best card ever. Every draft video, I'd have 1 or 2 in my deck, and I'd win every game off them, and I'd be like, this card's amazing. Why do I get it 11th? So, moving on, this next archetype is a little more conventional in that it was very obviously powerful in there, but what I found funny was what it made you do, and this is Affinity. At its best during Triple Mirrodin, still good during Mirrodin Darksteel, not that great during Mirrodin Darksteel 5th Dawn.
They kind of started replacing the Affinity cards with Sunburst and other mechanics.
Basically, you started losing Mirror Enforcer, Frogmite, and Thoughtcast, and Somber Hoverguard, which are all insane, and you got Quicksilver Behemoth, and then nothing.
Arcbound Hybrids.
Yeah, these cards that just were not as good. So, especially in Triple Mirrodin, I remember this is the year that Ben Stark top eight at two Pro Tours. And he said he would take Seat of the Cyanide, pick one, pack one over Grab the Reins. And Grab the Reins was one of the best cards in the set in terms of power level. And this is exactly what I'm talking about in these draft archetypes. So, it was pretty sweet.
They were, I mean, sometimes you were playing some innocuous artifacts, like your Scales or Tooths of Chisoria. But you were really, your Somber Hoverguard and Mirror Enforcer were really like the pound cards. You can get in there really early. You were taking every Spell Bomb.
Yeah. And the reason this format, this format and deck was so sweet is, like I've said before, I've played every single artifact that costs one or less mana in Mirrodin Block. Like, and there are some bad ones. There are like Tangle Blooms and, you know, Mirror Mind Shufflers or whatever it's called.
That guy actually costs two, but yeah.
But I played all the cheap ones. And, you know, Mirror Moon Vessel. Like, you end up playing all these one and zero mana complete do nothing artifacts because they're all Llanowar Elves, and you have seven or eight affinity cards in your deck, ideally. And you end up with, like, you know, if you're lucky, like five art, like the affinity deck with like five artifact lands, three Frogmites, two Mirror Enforcers, a Somber Hoverguard, and like a Thoughtcast was so good.
It's like two Ravagers away from constructed.
Well, yeah, exactly. So it was just insane. And you had Disciple the Vault with all the Spell Bombs, like every single Spell Bomb. And you had like all the other cheap, like Steel Wall, Viridian Longbow, which is also insane. All these other cheap artifacts, Leonin Scimitar. And you just ended up, I mean, you know, you go turn one, Artifact land, one drop. Turn two, Artifact land, one drop. Frogmite, Mirror Enforcer. I mean, you didn't do that very often, but every now and then, you know, you had a Welding Jar in there somewhere.
Like, yes.
You were playing with Moxes and Soul Rings, essentially. Like, all your Artifact lands were Ancient Tombs, and, like, Welding Jar was a Mox. Like, this deck was sweet.
It was fun.
This is the epitome of doesn't want any spell that costs more than four mana. Like, it doesn't have any actual more than four mana spells. Played 14 lands. Like, this deck was so sweet. You would certainly pass up, you know, Clockwork Dragon or something for a Frogmite. And that's just something that, for most people, is just unthinkable. So that was the key to these archetypes. The next one is near and dear to my heart because I'm still trying to play it online, though. I've kind of ruined that, unfortunately.
It was kind of the reason we did this, because it was most talked about recently. There are so many sweet card interactions in Innistrad. Spider spawning might be number one, but it's still very high. It's a card that creates a lot of just...
Yeah, basically, I wrote like an entire like article plus draft video plus draft walkthrough of the archetype, but it's still, to explain it in a very short amount of time, is you're basically abusing spider spawning and Knot of the Bone and ways to mill yourself, ideally with Runic Repetition, Memory's Journey, to make sure you don't get decked. And the sweet thing about this deck is it folds into a couple other decks too, because you end up drafting Burning Vengeance some of the time, you end up drafting Mill Them some of the time, but ideally you end up, you know, blue, green, black with 13 or 14 creatures and a bunch of mill spells and spider spawning, Knot of the Bone, Repetition, Memory's Journey, and you just turbo mill yourself, make a bunch of spiders, gain 20 life.
I've been on both sides of this one. Yeah. There are just some decks where it's like, oh, I've got, you know, Sweet Evasion guys, I've got good removal, like I'm ready for this draft, and it's like a bunch of do-nothings, a bunch of, you know, gain 20 life.
Your opponent,
like,
starts with, you know, dream twisting themselves, playing Mulches and Armored Scabs, you're like, what's going on? Then all of a sudden they spider spawning for 7 and Knot of the Bone for 14, and you're like, well, I can't kill him because he has a billion 1/2s and a billion life. And he's not going to deck himself because he just keeps doing this every other turn. And, like, when this deck's good, it's actually insane. Problem is, right now, it's, I think, very overdrafted online. You know, a couple weeks ago, you could wheel Knot of the Bone every single time, most of the time Dream Twist, and then you'll get a Spider Spawning 6. Now, you're just not seeing any of these cards. Like, you'd get Runic Repetition with two cards left in the pack. Now you have, you know, deranged idiots like myself third picking it. So, as much as I love this draft archetype and think it's good, you might want to give it a rest at this moment.
I'm glad we've talked it up one more time.
I mean, I can't resist. It's so sweet.
You've done your part. You've said everything you can. We're getting into the home stretch here.
I mean, when I open Dearly Departed and Dream Twist, I know which one I want to take. Yeah, it costs 1 minute. So the last and the sweetest was, I think, one of the most revolutionary when it first came out, or, you know, when it was first spoiled, as it were. And this is the Dampened Thought archetype in Triple Champions, but even in Double Champions, Betrayers was still kind of alive. Wasn't really alive when Saviors came out, but... So the idea was, you had Dampened Thought, which spliced on the Arcane and milled for 4. So your ideal deck had 0 to 2 creatures, both Teller of Tales, hopefully, which tapped or untapped every time you played, or maybe just tapped when you played.
No, it was either. It was Twiddle every time you cast a Spirit or Arcane spell.
Yeah. So you basically just had mono creature lists, and you just won by decking them. You had all these horrible, horrible Arcane spells. Psychic Puppetry, Ethereal Haze, Reach Through Mist.
Ethereal Haze, good.
Well, I mean, it's good for this deck. It's insane for this deck. But no other decks wanted any of these cards. Like Peer Through Depths, Sift Through Sands, Reach Through Mists. No, I never summoned the Unspeakable, but I know people who have.
And you still want to snag the Eerie Processions.
Yeah, Eerie Processions was really important too. Basically, you had like the key you know parts of the deck were like Psychic Puppetry, Ethereal Hills, Glacial Ray if you were insanely lucky. And you would use those cards, and Candle's Glow was unbeatable because it prevented three and you gained three.
That card was...
Basically, you'd play all these crappy arcane spells, and you'd splice all these defensive spells on, plus a Dampened Thought. And it didn't take that long to mill them out at four cards a shot, you know? And it was so hard to kill them when they... like basically, they would use Puppetry to... and if they're, again, lucky, Candle's Glow to preserve their life till in the beginning. Eventually, because the deck really didn't have much kill... they'd eventually get an actual massive army out, and then you'd start using your two Ethereal Hazes and never die.
So not everyone has played Champions Block, to bring it back to more common Magic terms, not only are you just, you're adding a spell onto these spells with the Splice Onto Arcane thing, but you're playing, you know, best case scenario, you're shocking something mill four. But a lot of times you're, you know, healing solve, both sides of healing solve, mill
four. Like one example would be like, you know, on turn four or whatever, you cast Reach the Mist, which is cycles. You splice on Psychic Puppetry to tap their 2/2, and then you Dampen Thought them. So you don't really take any damage, they mill 4. Then next turn, you cast Peer Through Depths. You splice on Dampen Thought. Well, didn't take damage that turn either. Maybe you take damage from the guy he played last turn, but you still only take like 2 damage. And you mill them for 4, and you look at your top 5, and you get another Arcane spell. And then you start bringing out the Candle's Glow, which prevents 6 a turn. And then you eventually have to use... Ethereal Haze, and then near the end, you start casting the Psychic Puppetry or Candle's Glow just to get the last couple dampens, and then just raw cast dampen as the last card. And it's so sweet because no one else wanted any of the cards for your deck. You would spend a lot of your picks hate drafting cards like Distress, you know, that would actually beat you. And you would end up with these like 21 spell, 19 land decks that were just like really, really, really good. And they would even side out all their creature removal, and then you'd play your one Teller of Tales game two. They wouldn't have a way to kill it, and they could never beat a Teller of Tales. So,
well, and it's like he taps down all your opponent's guys.
Yeah, I mean, he just sits there and ices all their guys, and then sometimes you just kill them with it. Like, it was a really fun deck to play, and Webb loved this deck so much. I remember we did a 2-on-2 draft, and he drafted Dampen Thought in a 2-on-2, which was just absurd. But he saw two Dampens in pack one, got them both. We beat our opponents, even though both of them had Kumanos, but... You know, that's a different story.
well, there you have it. A lot of sweet ones on this list. A lot of fun.
There are some ones that were close, but didn't quite get there. But if you have any draft archetypes you think were really sweet and that I overlooked, basically what you're looking for is ones that were not immediately obvious, for sure. Like Dampen Thought, it took months for people to realize it. Ones that would make you, you know, take the Dream Twist over to Dearly Departed, that sort of pick. And ones that won in a really novel and interesting way. I mean, not to say that normal limited is not interesting, because it's really fun to play limited, but it's so cool when you break out of the curve out creatures, play removal spells mold, when you start doing all these weird things. So these are the draft archetypes that keep me playing Magic, like, for sure. Like, once I started drafting most of these archetypes, I couldn't draft this format without going for it. So,
well, hopefully we'll have some sweet ideas in the comments, and as the formats roll through Magic Online, you'll be forced to try to make these things happen again.
Sadly, the Dampened Thought one, the best one, is no longer draftable, because even on Magic Online, it's triple set now, and you really can't do it there. Yeah, it just does not work.
That would really be, I mean, we already did a wishlist episode, but if they could bring back, you know, go even deeper for Moto, be like, oh, today it's
triple champions.
Triple champions. So,
thanks for watching, and be sure to chime in on your favorite draft archetypes.